here present. You've seen them perform. You've seen them around. So I'll be presenting my perspective, but there are lots of perspectives in the room. So if you have questions for me at any point in the lecture, please just start waving a hand, but I won't use all of the time. So there will be a moment for questions at the end. And of course, if you have questions for anyone else, then actually, Juan is the only one who's, and Omar are the only ones who are on the very last row. So they're also here. It's not just those guys. But yeah, so feel free. I'm sure everyone is happy to talk about it. But I'm gonna go ahead and get started. So who am I? I feel like that's a little bit of an important thing to say. I'm not in the little program booklet thing, and I wanted to make sure you knew who I was before I started talking at you. My name is Elizabeth. I grew up in Auburn, Alabama, and moved to Chicago for my bachelor's. I did a bachelor's in trumpet performance at Northwestern University. And then right after that, I had the intention to take a gap year for my studies, which was horribly interrupted by Pastor Zeslich. I'm joking, I was very good to be part of it. I actually didn't begin right at the start of the master's. I was sort of pulled into the master's through Invasion Explosion, which we did at the Opera Forward Festival in 2018, I believe, yes, 2018 in March. I came in as a trumpet player, sort of contracted in since I knew Marco, and we needed 9 trumpet players for that piece. And then as soon as I was in the hay, rehearsing with everyone else in the masters, I thought, well, I can't miss this. I have to be a part of this. So I sort of sneaked my way in and started the masters a semester late and was able to kind of play catch up and graduate with the rest of the class this past June after the production closed. And that's also now going into what actually was the Master's Elsleash. There were lots of parts of it. It was a formal education, a master's program within the Royal Conservatory in The Hague, but it was also the production in a large way. So I will talk about the production a lot in this presentation. I do want to say that there is going to be a time after I talk for a little bit to specifically address the production itself. So I'm sure that while I talk, there's going to be questions about dramaturgy, about staging, about practically what pieces were performed, how were they performed, who were they performed by. Those questions can be addressed, if not specifically addressed in this. So if you do have a question, again, you can shout it out, but don't be offended up and say, okay, no, we're going to talk about that later. So let's talk a little bit of an overview, quickly by the numbers. It's really hard to describe what this master's was in a brief way. This is as close as I could get. It was 15 hours of music in the production. There were lots of other pieces by Schrockhausen that we studied that weren't from Elsleash, and so were not part of the production. But 15 hours of music was sort of the culmination in the Elsleash production this past June. There were 14 students at Elsleash, 4 sound projectionists, 1 pianist, who you've seen perform here, 5 trumpeters, 4 of which you've seen perform here, 3 clarinet and bassoon players, and who you've seen in 1 flutist, who you haven't seen perform, but he's here at WA. And this also happened between 4 musical institutions. There was the Conservatorium in Den Haag, there was the Holland Festival, there was the Dutch National Opera and Ballet, and of course, the Schrockhausen Stiftung. And it was really a pretty intense and complicated collaboration between all of these institutions. Of course, you think about a master's program just at one institution is already a massive effort of a lot of people. And so to put on the production, which again was the culmination of this master's, but was also one of the biggest educational parts of the master's, that was really a huge effort by a lot of people. Within the actual curriculum of the master's, we had 5 lecture series by a lot of the lectures that you've seen already here at the courses and the house courses. 3 academic classes, 2 of which were prescribed master's classes that are usually incorporated in master's curriculums in the conservatorium, and then 1 elective, so we all took different things. And then 1 master's research week. We all had to give our own individual master's research presentations at the end of the master's, and then countless hours of lessons and rehearsals. There's really no way to quantify that. I'm lucky to have my teacher here, Marco. And the amount of, I think that's something that's really important to highlight, is the level of dedication. I think it's easy to see, because you see the production at the end, it's easier to see the dedication of the students, but the dedication from the teachers in the course is also really, really important, because they put a lot of their own time and effort into really creating this one-time master's, which, you know, I think it's easier for professors when they think they're going to get tenure at a school to really, like, give it their all. Sales Leash. Again, the students and the teachers, of course, but also the advisors, that's pretty clearly Renee Gunker, who put in a lot of effort in ways that really, I think, were unseen by a lot of people. The choreographers, the stage managers, the directors, the costume and makeup designers, and so many more. Again, those kind of, the last five of those were people who weren't academically involved in the masters, but they were a huge part of our education because they were a huge part of the production. And I think it's pretty safe to say that all of the master students who were in the production learned a lot from these people that we worked alongside, because just the pure level of professionalism that we saw demonstrated by these people, the level of detail that we saw, you know, just in the people who were running lights and were helping with costumes, and were like the creativity that were that was displayed by the makeup designers and the costume designers that really were interested in digging into the vision of Schockhausen and finding a way to make it work for this production. It was something that was, for me personally, a very educational experience, because you had people who also maybe weren't familiar with the music of Schockhausen who were coming in, seeing what we were doing and saying, wait, I can help them do that even more. And we'll get into why that was the case a little bit later. So let's see. I think it's important, because again, this was an educational program, to talk about what the goals were of the masters. And I said intended and unintended, it's maybe better to say the prescribed goals and the ones that were sort of achieved along the way because of the ones that were prescribed. Of course, the number one is the production. I think it would be naive to say that this master's was separate again from production. I think a lot of the motivation to create the master's was to find a way to make this production possible. I think in a lot of ways it wouldn't have been possible if it weren't for having students involved, both from just purely financial reasons, but then also just the sheer number of people. Because we also had students coming from Manchester and from Utrecht and some other conservatories. But again, that can be a conversation later when we talk about the production. And then the other is a goal that exists here also at the courses, which is to instruct the next generation of Schockhausen interpreters. Now, the unintended goals, there were so many. Lots can be added to this list. I sort of highlighted five that were big for me. That's one, how to operate in a big production. And that's when I say sort of the second classroom is often referred to in by educational systems, where you have the primary classroom, which is what you're doing actually sitting in class behind a desk learning, and then the secondary classroom being what do you learn from the environment that you're in. And the teachers in those places are often your colleagues, and again, like I said, the stage managers, the costume designers. And so learning how to operate in a production at that level and of just that size was a goal that I think we all achieved without really noticing it was happening, because we had to do it just out of necessity. The second is performing under stress. I think that's a goal that is often achieved in any kind of performance masters, but I think for this one, it's safe to say that the stress was pretty high. We did three main performances, four if you count the dress rehearsal, which was, I think, almost sold out as well, and of course, just the massive scale of what this was. It's a pretty decent level of stress. So learning how to deal with that and to really not just perform under it, but thrive under it was something that was, again, learned through the process of doing this master's in this production. Number three, how to approach music with a high level of detail and difficulty. Again, you know, this is something that is often learned in any kind of performance degree, but I think, you know, everyone here who is familiar with the music of Schockhausen is a different kind of detail, and it's a different kind of difficulty. Core movement and embodiment, something I'll go into later, was a big goal for me, and I think for a lot of the master's students, learning how to perform in this operatic way with this music that is sort of outside the comfort level of a lot of musicians, and finding a way to make that personal and to express that on stage to a really large audience in a really, really large venue. Number five, how to change your preparation to meet a specific goal. And I think that's something that maybe, you know, if you're in a traditional, and I keep comparing this master's to a traditional master's, not to say that this was, like, you know, just something requires you to change a lot of your preparation in a way that you wouldn't necessarily be forced to if you just had a one-time exam at the end of your master's. So I say all this kind of to give a general overview of what the master's was like. And I think because also I keep saying, well, in a traditional master's this, and in this master's this, and it kind of creates this idea that it is this very specific thing, which it is, but it was still highly individual. We all pursued different paths within this master's, and it also wasn't isolated. And that's to say that the goals themselves aren't isolated to the music of Schaffhausen. I think the skills that we all gained were very transferable to other types of music. And also ourselves, we weren't isolated to only playing Schaffhausen for 2 years. I think that's maybe a misconception that some people have, at least when I'm approached about the master's, they say, well, you're doing a master's in Schaffhausen for 2 years. Why are you only studying that music for 2 years? And I say, okay, well, let's break that apart because you can study this music in itself for 2 years and still have plenty to learn about it, but also that's not what we were doing. We all did play other things. And this is also where I want to give a bit of a disclaimer, which is that, again, I'm talking about my personal experience in the master's. I think that because I'm a trumpet player, maybe I neglected to say that I play trumpet, I think a lot of my approach to talking about the master's is going to be pretty specific to the instrumentalist view in this master's. It was very different, I think, for the sound projectionist, which I'm sure that you can ask them about, and they will be happy to share their experience a little bit more in detail with you about that. And also for the trumpet players, we were really lucky to have Marco, who had sort of came in with his pedagogy for us, and we were also able to take lessons with the Baroque trumpet teacher and the classical trumpet teacher within the Conservatorium in Dijon, and that was sort of an added bonus that I don't think any of us were really expecting to have coming in just because we wanted to study with Marco. So it wasn't isolated, and I think that's important to sort of note just so that you understand that the kind of the edge of the master's is a little bit blurred. So again, talking about my experience, just to give you a lens on what this was like, I included this photo. This is me playing the trumpet part in Orchestra Pilsen, because that's kind of actually what the whole master's felt like, is, you know, taking my trumpet and like walking through this aisle with smoke around it and a funny costume. It's kind of, you know, it felt like going into this crazy world, you know, the tape music from Orchestra Pilsen. For trumpet, you're kind of going through a jungle, and that's often what it felt like, to be honest. So as I explained before, I started in Invasion Explosion, and then I thought, well, I have to be a part of this. So then I moved to The Hague. We had two series of auditions for the solo roles in Das Licht, once in The Hague and once here in Cruden. We had movement and acting lessons. We had dramaturgical lessons to really dig into both the physical aspects of the roles we were going to be playing and the theoretical, actually on paper, musical aspects of all the different pieces. Throughout this whole process, the trumpets we performed several iterations of Proof and Abschied in various locations. We had the rehearsals all in Scheveningen, which is near Den Haag. And then after, I guess, a year and a half of rehearsing there, for the final month we actually moved to the Kasthalle, which was the where the event was happening in Amsterdam. We had costume and wig fittings. In case you didn't feel ridiculous enough, we're going to measure your head. And then we went into the tech and dress rehearsal period before eventually, finally, reaching the performances, which after all of this was kind of a release, I think, for a lot of us. It was sort of when you finally go over the edge of a mountain and you're like, oh, yes, now we're up here. And then you can look back and you can see everything you've done, which is a really special moment to have after all of that. So again, kind of trying to find different ways to summarize this. For me, it ended up being 6 pieces performed over all 3 days of the series in Das Licht. 6 different costumes, 1 wig, 3 different physical trumpets, 7 different mutes, 3 pieces from memory, and 4 of 31 days off in the month of May. I was talking to the other master's students about how to give an idea of what this was like, and someone said, well, maybe just photocopy your schedule booklet and just, you know, stand up there and click through train or working in sections or whatever it needs to be to make this happen. Of course, all of this comes with many, many challenges. Playing actually became the easiest part. And that's not to say at all that this music is easy, because we all know that it isn't, but it is kind of a dream to get to a place where it feels easy to do. And I think also it became the easiest part because that's what we're accustomed to doing. That's what we're trained to do. So actually getting into the physical act of playing became something that was sort of our first instinct, and playing this music really did become instinctual at a certain point. So the challenging parts were the things that went on top of that. And Stockhausen's music is incredibly layered, so of course the experience of performing it and producing it is also going to be extremely layered. There were interpersonal challenges. That's not to say that we all fought all the time. That's actually just to highlight that that's a really important skill to learn in any professional field, is to learn how to work with people, whether that's people that play your instrument, don't play your instrument, aren't even musicians. It's important to learn the skills of how to mediate those relationships and eventually, you know, be able to continue a working relationship, especially if you're doing a production that lasts over 2 weeks. There was the student versus professional challenge. I think that it would be remiss of me if I didn't mention this, because it was a challenge that I think a lot of the students faced, was this idea of, we're in a professional production, we're expected to be at a professional level and act as professionals, because even as students, you know that your colleagues are going to be your professional colleagues after you graduate. There's not really a line there. But also just within the context of the production, working next to people who were professionals and considered professionals by the production, to be considered as students who were really operating at the same level as these professionals, was a little bit of a challenge to deal with as far as also these interpersonal relationships went. And that's something that I think all the master's students are comfortable being candid about. So if you have questions about that specifically, you can hold them aside and ask about how that was. But I think that was a challenge because we all wanted to bring our A game. And then to be in an environment where someone's saying, yeah, okay, yeah, you need to play at this professional level, but you're still here because of this kind of somewhat arbitrary delineation between, oh, you're a professional and you're a student. There was a technical rehearsal period, which for me was something that was really challenging, because if you're a musician and you spend a lot of time with the music, rehearsing the music, and then you're thrown into an environment where the music and you are not important, to be honest. Like, you are, because they need you to see how the lights are gonna look on you, but otherwise you're really not important. And you know, you've been working hours and hours on this music and you're ready to play it really well, and then they say, okay, hang on a second, hold for lights, and you're in the middle of the note and you just have to stand there for an hour while they figure out what they're gonna do with the lights, and then they're like, yeah, okay, keep going, and you're like, oh God. You know, then that part is both physically taxing, but it's also kind of mentally and emotionally taxing, because you've invested yourself in this music and you want to perform it well, and suddenly it's not the focus. But through that, I think one thing that was interesting to watch my colleagues learn, as well as learn myself, was how to actually have chamber music with these elements of a stage production. So I wrote chamber rehearsal with lights. I know it was big for us, especially in Invasion Explosion, because we had performed it once already in the opera, but in the actual opera venue. So this was having the same piece again with the same choreography in a new venue. So adjusting our choreography to different lengths of the stage with different lighting cues, and working with our colleagues to say, I remember there's a moment where all the lights start flashing, and Chris said, hey, so, you know, when the lights do this, we should do this, and we play the note like this. And it was so clear to me that, I'm sorry I'm calling you out, but it's a good thing. He had figured out how to do chamber music with the actual staged elements of the music itself, which I think in Stockhausen is something that's really important to start considering as a musician, especially if you're going to go on to do this music on your own, to have an understanding of how these elements interact to enhance what you're doing for the audience, and to give yourself energy, is really, really important. And then, of course, there's the endurance aspect. It's a two-year master, so you do have time to train this endurance, but it's much easier to train the playing endurance, which I know the trumpets all did with Margot. How do you learn how to play for 6 hours and not feel like you're gonna die? That part is more more doable than the mental, physical aspect of endurance. And again, if you talk to some of the master's students, the way that they change their routines in their everyday life to prepare to have this kind of endurance on stage was really amazing. And it was different for everyone. For me, I think I started making sure I was eating healthier, eating the right amount. I realized I had to start eating a lot more to have the energy I needed to be on stage. But I know other colleagues, they were getting up really early, they were doing yoga every day, they were meditating, they were listening to scores at a specific time, a specific way. So it was really, this was something that was very individual, which is why it's hard to speak about, but it was something that happened, so I do want to highlight it. So again, I've been trying to think about how do I actually talk about what this was like, because I think that was, you know, I don't want to stand up and just say, well, this is what I did and this is what, you know, it felt like for me, but to give a really good idea of what this whole experience was like, I kind of was immediately drawn to Alex Honnold. I've been a rock climber my whole life. My dad grew up in California. This is a picture from Yosemite Valley. It's a really famous sort of just massive rock face that's become sort of a icon in the rock climbing world. And this guy, Alex Honnold, this past year free soloed one of the routes up El Capitan, which is free soloing means you do it without a rope. You're just up there by yourself, a little bit of chalk in a bag, and your shoes. So you can see him. That's him. And that's just the ground. there's a movie about it. I can't really recommend the movie if you don't like heights. But I enjoyed it. Because I saw a lot of what we were doing in this film sort of reflected in a way. This is just a model for scale. This is the route that he climbed. This is the Eiffel Tower. That's the Space Needle from Seattle. We've got the Empire State Building. We've got the tallest building, the Sears Tower, the Willis Tower in Chicago. So we think about things that are big, and then there's El Cap. So the idea of doing this without any safety, without any security, is kind of horrifying for those of us who aren't him, basically. And I think it's not unfair to say that maybe this is some of the performances that we had all done in the past, and this was us, least. and this is another kind of funny photo that I found to be maybe a bit of a metaphor for what it feels like to prepare and to be in the Masters. When Alex was preparing to climb Auslicht, he had tons of rehearsals. He went up there with ropes, he climbed every pitch with a rope thousands and thousands of times. He sat at the bottom and he drew out what the route was like and wrote notes on each part where his hand needed to go, where he needed to stretch his foot. He thought, oh God, you know, I can't quite stretch my foot comfortably for that one step I need to take. So he would spend a year stretching that one specific move. And then he would also just visualize himself going through it. He would prepare himself, well, what if I get up there and it feels scary? What do I do then? What do I do if my hands start sweating? I need them to not sweat. I need to learn how to deal with that fear. And usually when climbers do El Cap, they go up with ropes and they have this thing, which is called a portaledge, which they actually put up and they sleep in. They just stay up there for days if they're workshopping one 15-meter stretch out of the entire thing. They'll say, okay, you know, for this week, I'm up here, I'm living on the side of this cliff, and I'm working on this one thing. So this is also kind of what it felt like to be in the Masters itself, was just setting up a portaledge on the side of the cliff for 2 years. So you learn what it feels like to be on the side of a cliff and stay there and workshop it and become comfortable in that environment. This is him again climbing it. One of the things that he talks about, which was especially interesting to me, were that not all of, I think it's very easy to romanticize what he did, to say, oh, he did this amazing thing without security and he must just have nerves of steel. And he says, well, no, I don't have nerves of steel. I just prepared myself to the nth degree. If I feel nervous, something has gone terribly wrong. And a lot of his preparations weren't that exciting also. He talks about climbing up with a friend of his with an empty backpack because there was a spot in one of these cracks that just had a lot of loose rocks because rock falls happen. A lot of them get lodged. election, and he thought, well, not only if I'm up there and I think, oh, that's a rock I can put my hand on, it's actually loose, not only is that a danger to me, but if I knock a rock out, then it could hit someone below, and that could potentially endanger someone else. So he talks about going in with his friend and just taking loose rocks out of the crack, putting them in a backpack, and lowering them down. And when I heard him talk about that, I started thinking about all of sort of loose rocks that all of us had to go through personally and put in a backpack and bring down off a cliff, which often feels ridiculous, you know, to carry a bag full of rocks. But we did that. We had to do that work to be able to get to a place where you said, yeah, it's clear, the path is clear, there aren't hazards anymore, and I can do this. Which I think that last bit is maybe the most challenging part, is not just saying, okay, I'm prepared, but believing that you're someone who can accomplish the thing. And that's where I get into maybe the biggest challenge of the Masters, which I call becoming Michael. And of course, now that there are people who weren't playing Michael, there's Eve and Lucifer as well. But for the trumpet players, becoming Michael was one of the biggest challenges of this Masters and of the performance itself. And this actually gets into my Master's research topic, where I talked about embodiment and empowerment and what that means as a performer and how we can really train that and have it be a usable skill and just something that is a part of us as a performer. And just to clarify what I mean by embodiment, I actually pulled these three things from definitions from Cambridge and Oxford dictionaries. To incorporate, to give body to, and to personify. And these are all a little bit different, but I think the general sort of idea is taking something, bringing it in, holding it close to you, and finding then a way to give that back out. And I put this picture here because it's a great photo, but also because it does illustrate that in case you thought there was any giving away with anything on stage, we have these massive screens. So anything that Jerome and Denise did, and any of us did, were also projected on the big screen. So we had the challenge, of course, of just being on stage and being a visible figure on stage, but then also being this larger-than-life figure for the opera, which I think is in line with what Stockhausen felt of his music. He said it really is larger than life. But to go through all of these different things, the first incorporation, I think this has a lot of elements which are maybe familiar if you're already a performer, but it begins with detailed learning and really knowing the score. Susie made a great comment in Joe's lecture about how a lot of the interpretation that comes out of Stockhausen's music has to start from an absolute detailed knowledge of what the score entails. And I think a lot of times as musicians, you know, you think about if you know a piece, then it's you know the piece, you know all the details there, and that's, you've finished, you know the piece because you've learned what's in the score. That's actually just where you start. Once you have that place, congrats, you've made it to the starting line, and now you can actually start running. The second part is memorization. Of course, that's a big part of Stockhausen's music. A lot of it is required to be memorized. But I think that's an important element of embodiment, is actually having it physically ingrained in your memory and in your body. So that's why I said including muscle memory. The last thing you want to do when you're on stage is to be thinking about the notes you're about to play. So a lot of it is really, it has to be in your body so that then when you make a movement, the sound comes out of it directly. And that's why it's also practically helpful. The movements are practically helpful in memorization. A lot of those are in the score, of course. But with Invasion Explosion, it's so much easier to, if I had to stand here and play my signals to a tape, I probably could, but I would have a much easier time if I could start over there and walk this way and then walk back this way and walk up this way, because I would know physically if I'm here, I'm playing this signal, and when I give this impetus, the sound goes like this as well. Joe also, in Joe's lecture, I hope a lot of you were there because it was really great. He talked about didacticism in the movements, so something that really illustrates the music, and that's something that's helpful both for the audience and for the performer. And this is another level of embodiment where you're showing the music physically, but it also helps indicate what you're doing to your fellow performers and to the audience. of this concept of embodiment. We think about the music in Strauss, he talks about the music, the music itself, the tones, are the characters, or the protagonists, as Thomas Lemore says. And that was something that was really interesting for me to dig into, was to say, okay, if the music itself already is embodied in a way, the sound of Michael, the tones in the formula, that's already Michael, then how do I, myself, learn to play those notes in a way that brings Michael's character to me, and then I can hold it in me and give resonance and give character to those notes itself. And I think it simplifies the music of Stockhausen to say, oh, well, the music is the protagonist, so then we're just the vessels. We're really more storytellers or messengers. And finding a way to do that successfully is very individual and very challenging. And of course, again, it would be remiss to just ignore the fact that it is an opera. You are on stage, there are massive screens that Pierre Audi had going with live video footage. So there's a lot of thought that has to go into every action. And that doesn't mean every action is an act, but every action, none of them can be just casual. None of them can be thrown to the side, like, oh, I need to empty my spit valve. Okay, you can't do that as a trumpet player. You have to do it as a person on stage. But because Stockhausen composed for performers' bodies, he did compose these movements, and it was an opera. Something that was challenging for me was the gender aspect. And this is not to get into a massive dramaturgical discussion about gender in Stockhausen. That can happen, of course. I'd be happy to talk about it. But just for me personally, to say, okay, well, I'm playing the trumpet, which is, in Stockhausen's music, often Michael on stage. And there is a performance practice of Michael being played by men who are trumpet players. How do I use my body to bring this music to life in a way that is genuine to me, but also true to the music of Stockhausen? And that's where I really started to dig in with my sort of personal research and the research I did for my master's, was finding a way to find the power in my own body to convey music. And to have it not be forced, to not have it be something that's put on, but to have it be something that's genuine, because that's also what an audience can read. If you do something that is forced, then you also, in a very musical way, you kind of shut down your sound. You want to bring the music in as a trumpet player. You want that music to resonate in your body, quite literally and sort of metaphorically, so that you can bring that music to life in a way that gives energy both to your colleagues on stage, to yourself, and to the audience. And that's why I brought here this quote from Marshall McLuhan. If most people should probably be familiar with his idea of the medium being the message. And I think at first when I was working on this and struggling with the idea of gender in Stockhausen, I was thinking, well, if the medium is the message, and I have the wrong medium, then I must be sending the wrong message. And I really turned that around for myself and started thinking, well, no, the medium I have is the medium I have. I am who I am. I'm going to be on stage. We'll see what they do with the costuming. But I need to find a way to make the message one that's true. And so finding a way to take this quote and make it something that was empowering and say, yeah, like, my medium is the message. Like, let's go with that. And Jennifer Walsh, she has this beautiful article called The New Discipline. And that was something else that was really empowering for me, especially because I saw her at Darmstadt, which was another place that I was kind of struggling with this, because they, this past year, really tried to address the issue of diversity in new music. And she said, maybe what is at stake is the idea that all music is music theater. Perhaps we are finally willing to accept that the bodies playing the music are part of the music, that they're present, they're valid, and the informer are listening, whether subconsciously or consciously. And when you see Jennifer Walsh perform, she is all over this. She does a beautiful job with this. And taking her ideas in the new discipline about, yeah, your body on stage is valid, and it's part of the music itself, and really leaning into that and finding a way in Stockhausen's music, which I think really does lend itself to this idea if you run with it, and really invest the time in finding ways to make that happen. It can, Stockhausen's music is something that can help you learn how to do this. And I want to quickly jump, they don't know I'm going to show this, but I want to quickly jump and show an example of Jerome and Daniele, who is one of the other master students who isn't here, unfortunately, and he plays clarinet in this scene. Because I want to point out a couple things about to project your character on stage, which doesn't start with just the physical aspect, or doesn't end with just the physical aspect, but it's really about doing it also with your music, which I talked about, with resonance in your body. She was always working with us, trying to find ways of, you're playing the note like this, and that seems difficult, so what if you played it like this, because then you're also sending your energy in that same direction. And it was wonderful to work with her, because she's not a musician. She would try to sing some of the parts of Chocolate, and she's like, yeah, but the part where you play, that part, so go from there. I'm like, Julia, which part do you want us to do? She's like, I'm sorry, I'm not a musician, but she really learned, just from working with us, how musicians operate, and she was able to help feed us and find more ways for us to really make this music come alive physically. And I'll show one more example, just because it's hard to resist. Chloe and Overlipitas did a really, really amazing job of having this kind of projection and personification. Again, she's sitting like this now, because I didn't want her that I was going to show this. But she had an extra challenge, even though, of course, she was helped by the shiny blue suit that she was wearing. She was also on a moving block, which gives physical challenge, actually, to playing the music. If you're standing on something that's moving by, like, a little robot kind of control situation, it's already challenging enough to do that. But to find a way to project energy, not just from a fixed spot, but from somewhere that was moving. So she had to kind of give extra oomph, for lack of a better word, to what she was doing, so that she, as someone moving from the back of the auditorium to the front, side to side, eventually climbing stairs, finding a way to have that energy carry from the movement that she couldn't control into her own movement and also into her playing. Maybe my learning who inspires. I think who, I mean, learning and inspires are kind of are literally the big words in this quote, but I think the who is really, really interesting. John Green is a writer, and he has a fun podcast if you want to check it out, but he talks about the things you love and why, and how you love them, and asking the question, does this love sustain you? And if it does, how does it do that? And really researching that is a great way to build community. And I think a lot of people, if, I mean, of course, if you're here, it's because you have a love for this music. And the reasons for that love can be many. And I think the reasons for all of us to do the masters were many. But understanding why we love the music and how we love it is something that we can use to grow the who of learning who inspires. Because that's something that you can then more readily bring to other people. And it can also inform how you perform the music as well. And I think that's maybe the biggest responsibility for the next generation. If we're here at Britain talking about building the next generation of Shackleton performers, and especially the masters, that's the kind of the responsibility. And it's easy to talk about the challenges of the masters and exactly what was in the curriculum and what could have been better. And that's certainly a conversation that should be had. But I think the biggest thing when you think about challenges is the responsibility aspect of the challenge. What do you do with that challenge as someone who is going forward, having learned from those challenges? And then to take this quote, learning who inspires, and expand the question to learning what inspires, learning when it inspires, learning when, why, and how it inspires. Because asking those kinds of questions, I think, is the only way to take next steps. And I've then kind of concluded with, what's next? And totally self-indulgent with this photo, because I just think it's great, Marco and the trumpets that were in Passage. So it is now 3:20, which is just about on time, because from 3:30 to 3:40, we're going to have sort of a roundtable discussion about the production itself. But I wanted to give anyone who has a question time to do that now. And then if there are any questions, we'll take a break and maybe kind of move the chairs into more of a circle to talk about the production. But does anyone have any questions? No? Cool. Well then,
what's your next piece?
My next piece?
Yeah.
Of Shackleton?
Well, after this production, what is the first thing you want to do?
I would really like to do audience. And really, because I started working on it, you know this, because I played it for you in lessons. I started working on Audius with Marco, got kind of partway into the memorization of it when the big final push for the production hit, so it got put on pause. But I'm excited to come back to it because I think, especially with Audius, where there isn't a lot of stage movement in the score, really a lot of the challenge of that piece is standing still. So I think using what I've learned from the masters and finding a way to make a very still performance captivating with just trumpet and tape is something I'm really excited about doing. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, me. you talked about, you know, the embodiment and all of that sort of stuff, and you gave, you know, showed that example of Chloe and Over Living Cuts. What for you was the main, I guess, sort of, what mainly enabled you to achieve that, and I guess it's maybe also a question Chloe answers, you know, to grow into those parts where you stop being a trumpet. I don't mean stop being just a trumpet player.
No, yeah.
I don't mean just a trumpet player. I mean, I'm just a musicologist, so what do I know? But transformed you. You know, what was the main driver? Was it the music that did that? Was it the experience of working on this in this atmosphere? You know, what turned you from a trumpet player to Michael?
I think my first reaction would be to say the music, because personally for me, Marco's always saying, okay, Elizabeth, just do it, which I think is really good feedback for me, because I'm someone who my first impulse is to really just think a lot about things. Which is good. I think it's good to be thoughtful. But I think at the end of the day, if you ask Alex Honnold, well, how did you climb El Cap without a rope? He would say, well, I started. I did it. Mm-hmm. You know, at the end of the day, you have to put yourself out there and take the first step. And I think that's kind of what we all had to do. At a certain point, you know, the training wheels were off, and we had to just trust that we could do it.
title, that guy,
Rock
with The Rock.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, exactly.
And in a sense, it's the same with the musical, and I would you to meet the music challenges as opposed to music.
Yeah, I think one thing that climbers are always saying, and I mean, I have a very vivid image of my dad at the bottom of the rope screaming this at me, is trust your feet, because it's really, when you're in an exposed position, your impulse, especially if you're on a rock cliff that you're nervous about, you know, is this tiny little thing I'm stepping on going to hold me? The last thing you are thinking about is trusting that, you know, dying edge on a rock face. But you do have to just at the end of the day trust your feet and know, okay, this rock face, it's not that, it's the massive mountain that it is. And I think, again, Joe, in his lecture, he showed a picture of this, like, stratified rock. And Stockhausen's music, saying Stockhausen's music is like that. There are tons of layers, and it's huge, it's a mountain, it's really solid. And so if you do understand and have that appreciation for the music and lean into that, I think that's where the first step can come from often. Any other questions? Cool. I do encourage everyone to speak to the other masters as well if you have questions, because again, I kind of have to keep giving this disclaimer. This was my experience, so this view of the masters is from my perspective, and I know that a lot of them can add to it or say something, you know, different from what I said, and that's really important as well. We do have